can go. I didn't hear entire previous presentation, so topic of religion and politics during Trump presidency is incredibly interesting and still needs lots of research, but it's fascinating. You mentioned, Dr. Napierała, you mentioned this concept of Cyrus, and just before election and during at the beginning of pandemic, bookstores like Barnes and Noble, very prestigious bookstores, had in store books about destiny, a special destiny of Trump as a person chosen by God. Usually Isaiah, fragments from Isaiah was used to prove that even Cyrus was the king of Persia, and he was not a Jewish king, because this is Old Testament, so not even a Christian, but Old Testament, he was chosen by God for special, to do special things. And as you remember from history, Cyrus ended so-called Babylonian exile of Jewish elite and allowed a rebuilding of the Temple of Jerusalem. So he had this special mission. He was chosen by God. And as you mentioned, yes, he's a sinner. Yes, he's not a religious. He's not even ours. But in this point, it was this Christian perspective. But he was chosen by God, and we have obligation to vote for him because he has this special mission to fulfill. So this religious motivation is incredibly interesting, and several books which were published and were broadly available. Also, they are still available online, not in bookstores anymore, but analysis, political and religious analysis of argumentation is really worth to worth research. It's quite fascinating and quite unusual. Nothing like this happened before. So this is an absolutely exceptional situation. But today I wanted to start from American tradition of presidential elections and till basically debate in 1960 when President, I'm sorry, JFK, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, not a president yet, became one of candidates. Debate started about abilities of Catholics to become American presidents. And Billy Graham, someone will have presentation on Billy Graham during this presidential election, strongly opposed a candidacy of a Catholic. His argument was that Catholic would follow instruction from Rome, from Vatican, from the Pope, and he wouldn't follow American Constitution, American law. So election of a Catholic is against American tradition. Of course, when Kennedy won, this situation started to change, and Billy Graham started to look at Kennedy in different way. But again, if you look at argumentation which was used during this campaign, this is incredibly interesting phenomenon, looking, showing a perception and cognitive processes, which on social level, which is very interesting to present. But if we look at tradition of Billy Graham, we have to remember WASP, white Anglo-Saxon Protestant. This is a description of American elite till election of JFK. So first century, end of the, I'm sorry, end of the 18th century, 19th, first half of the 20th century was dominated American political elite. So all presidents till Kennedy belong to this group. You had to be not just white, Anglo-Saxon, but also Protestant. Kennedy was of Irish origin, and he was a Catholic. So this is the first and for a long time, the only exception. Now, if we look at religious rhetoric in a presidential election, basically we should start from election of 1980, when we have two candidates, Ronald Reagan and Jimmy Carter, who tries to be reelected for the second term. And again, we start to see use of religious argumentation in political debate. This is something what was very new during this time. Presence and political involvement of Jerry Falwell, senior, of course, Jerry Falwell, founder of Liberty University, and Pat Robertson became very important, but entire phenomenon to invigorate Protestant, fundamentalist, evangelicals, conservatives to go and to vote. It was very new phenomenon of this scale. So if we look at religious rhetoric, we should start from, I believe, 1980. Did we have this kind of argumentation before? Yes, from time to time, we have to remember Thomas Jefferson. During his election, a new issue appeared. He was accused of being an atheist. And the question was, could or should atheist be American president? But as we know, Jefferson won, and this issue was discussed. During the 19th century, it is absolutely marginal situation because everybody belonged to WASP. Now we have another issue, because sometimes researchers look at religious beliefs of candidates, let's say Trump, Reagan, or Jimmy Carter. During this election, when Jimmy Carter faced Ronald Reagan, we have to remember that Jimmy Carter was genuinely religious. He is a Southern Baptist, supporter, and his private life is without any sensation, is a very traditionally Christian. He's very traditionally Christian. And a person who was really Christian was rejected, and politician, Ronald Reagan. And again, we can look at his life, but it is not a matter here. But when we observed a choice which was made, not a religious person, really religious person like Jimmy Carter was chosen, but very good politician, good for religious right during this time, Ronald Reagan. So this is the first situation which was worth to observe in a context of political rhetoric. What was used, what kind of argumentation was used, what kind of rhetoric was used to support Ronald Reagan? So this is the beginning of very, I think, important phenomenon, which is not fully researched, I believe, because we have several works on religion and politics, religion and elections, but we should concentrate on the voters. What voters would like to hear about their candidates, personality, which is usually discussed in research, is not the primary issue. And a case of Ronald Reagan and Jimmy Carter proves this situation. So the question is, what kind of religious expectation had Christian? And in this point, I'm not talking only about Protestant, very general way, because we deal with different churches, Protestant churches, and a variety of evangelical groups, which supported, but slowly also conservative Catholics started to join this group of voters, because I'm talking about voting and voters. After that, we have another very interesting election, 2000, when G.W. Bush became a president. And again, we have problems of religious rhetoric and personality. G.W. Bush was portrayed as a sinner when he was young, till 40 or 41. He goes through religious change, and he is born again at the age of 40 or 41, and he became conservative evangelical Christian. So this is this official version, and this is how he was portrayed. And in both elections, we have issues which became very important and broadly discussed. So of course, we have issue of abortion, and we have issue of gay marriage during the second election, 2004. Opponents usually ask questions why these two issues were picked up, and why these issues were exposed. So again, I would go back to the voters. It is not, again, about a political elite. Dick Cheney had a daughter who was gay. So this is not about personal beliefs so much. This is about the voters. What was important for voters who would decide to go and vote for G.W. Bush? On the other hand, we have argumentation which we cannot dismiss during, which took place during this debate, 2000-2004. I'm talking about just a time of election and presidential campaign. For example, a famous American writer, Kurt Vonnegut, asked question, and this question was repeated. He just, in one of his essays, he wrote about it. He asked question, why Christians, conservative Christians, don't quote Jesus? They go back to Old Testament, but they ignore totally teaching of Jesus. For example, why don't politicians use Sermon on the Mount? Why they don't use Beatitudes? This is the essence of Christianity and teaching of Jesus. But these issues, of course, didn't appear in political debate. So when we observe campaign and when we observe arguments used by supporters and people who opposed, we deal with different religious issues. It is not about being for abortion or against abortion, but the question which was asked considered problems such as New Testament, like the Gospels, like teaching of Jesus. So this is this issue which is also interesting, and I believe absolutely worth research, because usually in research we concentrate on arguments used by this side which is winning the election. What kind of counter arguments were used? And in this point, we have much broader spectrum. What was discussed during presidential elections? And the next question, why this or that argumentation is winning? We know that during the first term of G.W. Bush, it was a problem of his very religious supporters who created this council, religious council, faith council. They were frustrated because promises from campaign were not fulfilled. like promise to limit or end abortion. And they waited to make these promises true, and nothing happened. So we have another problem, which we can observe in debate before the second election, 2004. Why these promises were not fulfilled? And argumentations were okay, we have war on terrorism, we have war in Afghanistan, we have war in Iraq, so we couldn't make it. Opposition, and very Christian opposition, said we could do much more than it was done. That, and even with accusation that it was just an empty promise to win election. So again, analysis of entire argumentations during both presidential elections is incredibly interesting and important to understand what was going on. Now, I mentioned very briefly about WASP. So what we have right now during last few years. First of all, WASP, when we have white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, is changing. We have right now the second Catholic president in the United States. Joe Biden is a Catholic, and he's the second president who is not a Protestant. Now, we observe also very interesting changes in terminology. What was defined as Christian from 1950s, this is, of course, influence of Cold War and what was going on in 60s and 70s. From Christian, we started to talk about Judeo-Christian tradition. So this is broadened already. In 1990s, we start to observe use of term Abrahamic tradition, everything what comes from Abraham. In this point, we have not just Judeo-Christian, but also Islamic tradition. And because a group of Muslims is growing, Muslim voters, I'm not talking about people who are Muslims, but Muslim voters. Again, we observe changes in rhetoric. People of the book, it means in chronological order, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. So it would be the same or very similar set of values. Another issue is also quite interesting. Donald Trump introduced to in political life his oldest daughter, Ivanka Trump, and her husband, Jared Kushner. Jared Kushner is an Orthodox Jew, and Ivanka converted to Orthodox Judaism to marry him and to have Jewish children. Now, this issue was never used during campaign against Trump. It means we observe changes in perception of religious affiliation. No one used argument in campaign against Joe Biden that he's Catholic, he shouldn't be elected. No one used argument that Ivanka or Jared Kushner shouldn't be present in political life or White House, shouldn't be so much involved in politics because of their religious affiliation. So the situation is changing because not just politics is changing, society is changing. And what was not acceptable before in this category of WASP is absolutely acceptable today. No one used an argument against Kamala Harris that she was raised in Hindu tradition by his mother, because her father was Episcopalian. So again, we have new religious issue right now. Another religious issue, which was not used against Kamala. Her husband is Jewish, and his religion is Judaism. So these arguments are not used anymore against a candidate. And I believe it shows changes, social changes, culture changes, which we observe today. And at the end, just a brief question about situation today and perhaps perspective. What would be, what kind of religious argumentation we can find in elections? And of course, I didn't touch many issues from previous elections, but let us look at the future. According to different polls, about 26% of the population right now, especially younger voters in 20s, 30s, don't want to have specific religious affiliation with specific religious organization. They would describe themselves as Christians or spiritual, or there are different types of description, but they don't want to be affiliated with a specific church. So the question is, what kind of religious rhetoric we can expect in the future? What kind of issue would become important for younger voters? Because they would vote not what is, not always what is right or wrong, but what is right or wrong according to them. So this is their perception, their choice, and we observe also generational change. Older generation votes very faithfully to traditional candidates with so-called traditional values. But this generation is getting older and slowly disappears in the society. Now, younger voters, voters in their 30s, 20s, probably 40s, but this is the major issue. And the question would be, what kind of argumentation would be accepted or important for this generation? And I'm not talking about some minorities. In election, the point is to get as many votes as possible. Every vote is just counts as one vote. So numbers are incredibly important. When we look at elections and involvement in election in 80s of Jerry Falwell or Pat Robertson, this is one of arguments was belonged to tradition of Christian Zionism. So in this point, this issue was very important for younger, for voters during this time. How could be used in the next election in 2020s? Who would believe that this is an important issue? And we know right now that some issues like gay marriage, which was absolutely the hottest topic of election, one of hottest topics, because we also, we were in war in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and it was a war of terrorism, but on terrorism, but gay marriage as moral issue was a very hot topic. Today, it wouldn't be. Most of states accepted or legalized gay marriage. So this issue is not the hottest issue anymore. So the question is, what kind of topics would be important for younger generation? Because we have several elections ahead. We have midterm election very soon and the next presidential election, which is coming. What kind of religious argumentation we will find in the future? Thank you, and I count on questions.